shamanism. Welcome to With Insights Radio. I'm your host, Iggy Garcia. I will take you on a journey across the universe through shamanism, metaphysical, and holistic. So sit back and relax and enjoy the show.
Welcome to Iggy Garcia Live, episode 23. Today, we're going to be talking about connections. That's probably kind of a vague statement there, but it's one of those things that came to me today, just because of the fact that I've been hanging out with my dad for the last couple of days. He's had surgery on his gallbladder. He had it removed. He had really bad attack. He's one of those guys who is, one of those matriarch type Latin father figures who doesn't really show his emotions a whole lot. And when he's in a lot of pain, he kind of holds back a little bit. So he is that's the kind of dad I have. So when he's doing something, he doesn't really show you. Even if he got hurt, it's very rare that you see him cry. So I got to spend like the last few days with him, just sitting next to him, talking to him at the hospital and hanging out with him. And I tell you, he's an interesting guy. You think you know somebody and you think you have an idea about who they are and where they come from and, their story. And I'm surprised, even though I'm his son, you think I would be a little bit closer to him. And it's been an interesting time. And I want to thank everybody who's prayed for my dad. And friends, family, everybody who's, sent some kind of love his way, because you can see it in his face, you can see it in his color. He'll be discharged on Monday. They figured they wanted to keep him just a few more extra days just to make sure, since he kind of lives by himself. He has his own apartment. They want to make sure that he is able to recover somewhat well, since he's such an independent type of guy. He likes to do everything on his own, doesn't really like to ask for help and stuff. But it was nice to sit there and learn from him about our family, our history, and where we come from, what it means. And, my two brothers have been really involved in making sure that he's okay. My brother Gino is actually the one who ended up taking him to the hospital, because my mom was having a hard time getting hold of me and to come get him. So like 4 a.m., he ends up going to the hospital because he's having this really panic attack and a pain attack about his health, and talks to my mom, and my mom pretty much tells him to go to the hospital, go to the emergency room. Stubborn, doesn't really want to go. And then, my brother Gabe as well, he's been helping my dad out and just making sure that all his affairs are taken care of, which is awesome. And but he's on vacation now, so Gabe kind of recommended to the doctors that maybe Puppy should stay a few extra days just to kind of get a little bit more stronger. And today I saw him stronger. I saw him doing very well, and he's doing very much better than he was. There was some little concern about his discharging. There's a pump on him that for releasing the chemicals that are in your body, blood and everything that's in there. But everything's good now. And just all the people who've come to visit him, friends and family. I want to thank my sister Bicey and her kids. Bill Finzel, the Dulciato, just came by to see my dad. And to David, Adriana, Mary, and other friends who've stopped by. It means a lot to him that people really care about him. And, for him, it's his vacation time, as he would say. some people go to beaches and some people go and do stuff. Him just being able to just kick back and lay back is a lot. And anybody who knows my father knows that's how he is. He's a tough dude. He's a little guy, but he's tough, and he's just reminiscing, and it's really cool to watch him reminiscing about his life and where he comes from. And so, I started thinking about, what am I going to talk about on my show? My shows are spontaneous, so I do them when I'm kind of led to spirit to talk about them. So I thought about, love, and I thought about, fear, and I was thinking all these things, the same old, but, and then it finally struck me, connections. I was thinking about, how are we all connected? Everybody in some way or another is connected some way. So I got to learn a lot about, my family, the German side of the family, and how they immigrated to this country, how they immigrated to Peru, and how they did and helped and, you know, did all kinds of stuff. You know, I heard stories about, you know, things that I wasn't sure I knew about, but I wasn't sure. And, you know, stories about how the Bush family came to America and who brought them on the ship, you know. Peter Lemke is one of my ancestors who brought the Bush family to America. They lived in Columbus, Ohio. Most people don't know that the Bush family are from, they lived in Columbus, Ohio, and they're from here. They're from here. Neil Bush, you know, and all those guys, Prescott Bush, you know, they own Buckeye Steel. Most people don't realize that. And that's why George Bush has a strong ties to Ohio. And that's why Ohio is such an important state. But besides that, you know, you get to learn about, you know, your dad a little bit more, what he's did, what he's done, and who you are also. And that's probably the big thing. So how, why you are the way you are. And I watched him working, you know, kind of his magic, but he does it, you know, in his own heart, how he's a very charming man. He's really very kind when he's in his, you know, when he's in the place where he needs to just kind of relax. So I watched him talking to the nurses, complimenting everybody, and they really took care of my dad. I mean, they went way far and beyond. Then I was surprised that, you know, he got the attention he got. People just came in the room to talk to him and hang out with him. So I thought that was really cool. I thought it was really neat. And it wasn't, there wasn't a surprise to me, because I kind of grew up with that man who he kind of did that. And but it was nice to see him just slow down. And unfortunately, his body had to tell him to slow down. But that's us. That's us as human. He's my father is us. You know, I am him. We're all related. And, you know, sometimes we have to slow down. Sometimes we have to, you know, realize that our tempo, our bodies need, you know, re-energizing, taken care of. And we need to, you know, take care of this flesh as well as our spirit. So the connections that I was, you know, thinking about, I was just thinking about all the people connections, how I was going through life, learning and meeting, but how the connections we have as individuals, as people that, you know, we touch in our communities. All of us touch somebody in a spiritual way or a physical way, but we touch people's hearts, we touch people's minds, and we have these connections. A lot of you who are online here, you know, I know most of you personally, most of you, and some of you I haven't met yet, but yet there's a connection, and the connections and the thin threads between us, you know, and that's all it is sometimes, is a thin thread, how we know each other. And so, you know, it was a beautiful thing just to be, you know, with my elder, my father, and watch him, you know, going through his process of, you know, going through his healing and going through his process of, you know, letting go and purging things in his body that didn't serve him anymore. So, you know, his gallbladder had a lot of gallstones, and, you know, he worked really hard the Sunday before. He just bust his butt, you know, cutting tree branches down. Some of you guys saw that on Facebook. That's the type of guy he was. But, you know, when we were done doing the work, he was really super hungry. And, you know, he had a lot, he probably ate more than he should have. And Kentucky Fried Chicken and cake and stuff. So I kind of spiraled, you know, your body communicates to you kind of funny. It almost like it wanted it and needed it in order to get him to that state, where he actually had to feel the pain that he probably had been feeling and not wasn't sure. And so that pain inside his body finally just let go. And finally put him in the hospital. And, you know, and we and Dad and I were talking about how if we were born maybe in 1500 or, you know, 100, you know, AD or something like that, would we have survived without modern medicine? And I would have to say, personally, I know that I wouldn't have survived because of the surgery that I've had in the past and certain things that happened to me and certain things happened to my mother. But I also thought maybe our diets would probably be completely different as well. We probably would eat much different than the way we eat now. So, the effects would be completely different. But all those things cross your mind when you're sitting there in the hospital and there's people next across the way with you, across behind the curtain, and you can hear their stories and they can hear our stories. And it was really, it was kind of interesting. And finally, my dad and the guy next to each other met and they said hello. And the guy in the room next to me, next to my dad's curtain, he had a hernia and he had the same condition I had, you know, almost 10 plus years ago. And I'm thinking, I'm sitting going, oh, no, that's not a coincidence. I said, that's spirit talking. That's spirit talking to me at some level. And that kind of made me realize about connections, how I'm connected, how you're connected, how we're all connected. No matter what our religious beliefs, no matter what our, you know, our genders or whatever, we're all connected to this Mother Earth. That somehow, in some way, we communicate. In some way, we are part of everything and nothing at the same time, which I thought was really cool. So this guy has a similar condition that I had, you know, 10 plus years ago. And it was a message for me to say, you know what? You also need to take care of your body, Iggy. You need to take care of your temple. Even though it feels great, I feel good. But there's more I can do. There's more in my body than I can work on. More things that I can, you know, address. And so I'm thinking there going, you know, because I cut fast food out a lot. But even if you cut out certain foods, you still have to exercise. You still have to maintain, you know, some kind of activity, you know, to tone your body and to get into that physicality that you want to be. But it was a wake-up call, too, for me sitting there and watching my dad going through his process. My dad, I think, has only been to the hospital 4 times in his whole entire life. I mean, the very first time I remember him going to the hospital is when we were young kids in the 70s when he had lung cancer. He had some rare form of lung cancer, and, again, he was at OSU, and they did some experimental, you know, a procedure on him, which they do at universities like that because it's a school, like, it's a university, students learning experiments. And, you know, they shot him with certain types of, radiation type stuff and, you know, pretty much burned and, you know, a hole in his inside of his lungs. I don't know how they did it, but he's cured. And the other time I remember him, he had a hematoma in his leg and that took him to the hospital. And I think one other time he got hurt, but that's all I can remember. That's the kind of father I grew up with. Someone who was really, he hid his pain very well, especially his emotional pain. And a lot of us do that. We hide our emotional pain from people. But I'm a little bit different than my dad. I'm a little bit more letting go about my emotions. I'm a little bit more freer. But I saw my dad also open up and change too. I saw a person completely change in his healing through this process just in the last few days. I saw a person whose color changed on his body. I saw a person whose heart, you know, was opening. You know, I saw a person who is that. He knew there was things going on around him, but he didn't, you know, he didn't let it bother him. You know, his gallbladder was damaged just because of, you know, the gallstones and everything that just built up over time. And, but the surgery is what he needed for him, his mind and for his physicality and what he thought he had to be at. But I saw a change in him. I saw a change in him today. You know, where it goes from here, I don't know. To sit there and watch him actually transform before my eyes and just let go of certain beliefs and certain energies and certain things that you maybe he held on to before, and him, you know, communicating with my mom on the phone and talking to everybody and just, you know, maybe it was a call for attention. Maybe it was a way for his body to say, hey, I need attention. And maybe he was a way for his mind to also call for attention from everybody. But either way, you know, I spent the last 2 days just hanging out with him. And learning from him things that I probably wouldn't have learned about history, about our family, just about things that he likes, things that I didn't, you know, didn't realize. You know, my dad didn't always want to be a restaurateur and own properties. He actually wanted to be a scientist. He wanted to explore. He wanted to be an astronaut and he wanted to do certain things and it didn't happen. But, you know, he's content with, you know, with what his life and the path he's on and the way he's going. And he's excited. And I saw him being excited about, you know, being able to live, you know, and to be able to move forward. Well, at last, I don't know. It doesn't matter at this point. For me, it doesn't really matter. It was just the moment that I was able to spend with this human being, this other person who happens to be my father, and get to spend moments with the people who also were visiting my father and listening to the stories, especially when his old friends came in. I mean, friends from 25 years ago. And I thought that was really, really, really cool. Because they just didn't stop talking. You know, I got to a point where I was really, you know, just falling asleep. Not because I was bored, but they were just catching up, you know. And I had no reference points to pop any, you know, just to get involved. But I listened, and it was fun. It was fun to watch that. It was, the interaction was pretty cool. But, you know, Papi Gino, he's a tough guy. And he does things his way. And but those connections, but we all have connections. Every single person on here is connected. We're all connected together. We're all somehow connected. We're all have met somewhere, past lives, future lives, you know, interdimensional lives, you know, spiritual lives. And so that's one of the things that I'm excited about to share with you. You know, what's your connections? How do you connect to the world? How do you respond or react when people come to you? For example, today I was not really much on Facebook because I was busy having, you know, human interaction versus a human interaction through media, multimedia, and much different. And I tell you, it's I kind of miss those days where you just kind of sit and chill with somebody and talk with them. Things aren't misunderstood, and if they are misunderstood, you can actually correct them very quickly and very fast, versus trying to explain a sentence that you may have written without certain punctuations and, you know, certain sentence structures, and can be misconstrued. I saw a video today, okay, and this video was of this priest, and this was a video someone shared from somebody else, and certain comments were said that, you know, I didn't agree with. But this priest had a Superman logo on the back, and then the Batman on his cleaver, and this is a Catholic priest, and he's in Mexico, and he's squirting kids with holy water and this gun. Maybe that's a true story, maybe it's not. But the point for me was, you know, this guy had brought people to spirit, to God, to Jesus, and he's bringing them in a way that has never been done in this particular town, according to the story that I was listening to. And I got kind of triggered because, you know, I've been raised to try things. And I know other people have been put in situations where they're not allowed to express, or, you know, they have a dogmatic way and that's the way they're supposed to do it. But when I decided, you know, that I was raised Roman Catholic, and I decided that not all of that resonated with me, that Christianity didn't all resonate with me, that there were some aspects of it that, you know, are beautiful, and then some aspects that I don't get. And that's okay. That's for me. But I never really got flack from my parents about not following a certain path. And that was concern about me, but you know, they trusted that I was going to make the right decisions, I believe. But they did give me a foundation to start from. So that's the connection I have through spirituality. But what I find that, you know, my connection through spirit is much larger than, you know, the stories that are told in books. My connection to spirit is dirt, is stars, is plants, animals. It's you, this technology I'm using, and to connect to spirit in that way, and to be open to the possibilities that anything can happen, and that the bad things aren't necessarily bad, and the good things aren't necessarily good. They're just words that we associate with things, but they're just experiences, and these experiences are magical, or they could be very challenging. And so I find that my connection to spirit was, you know, that when I saw this story about the guy who's doing this, I think my friend didn't say, but the guy who there said, this guy's an idiot. And I'm thinking, well, and I posted, well, what about, you know, Wounded Knee, when the Calvary went in there and saw all the Native Americans doing the ghost dance, and because they wanted to pray, that was a form of praying, but they all got shot, they all got slaughtered, they all got killed, because somebody didn't understand their belief system, didn't understand this is what they're looking at. They probably thought they were idiots too, and they probably thought that it was the satanic. And, you know, so they killed women and children. So when we dictate other people's belief systems and their connections to spirit, you know, we're imposing our judgment upon them. You know, I believe, and this is just my belief, that we should allow people to have their own connection. And their own connection should be their connection and how they experience the great spirit, how they experience God, how they experience the universe. Because when we start to impose our beliefs on other people, then they have to take part of us into them in order to understand it. But it's hard to be somebody else. It's very difficult to be another human being. It's difficult enough just to be ourselves. You know, it's hard for me to be me sometimes, but I do my best. I do my best. So this connection, you know, about this guy, the way he did, how he communicated to spirit and to the universe, was the beautiful thing I saw. Now, would I have done that? Possibly not. I may have not done it the way he did it, but that's the way he did, and that's how he reached people, and that's how he communicated to people. You know, he didn't dictate someone's belief system. He just said, let's have fun experiencing spirit. Let's have a different way of experiencing spirit. let's have a different way to experience Christ. Let's have a different way to experience God, I guess. And, you know, that's what I saw when I saw this video when this guy was doing this. Because that was the way Spirit plays. God is also humorous. Spirit is humorous. Spirit is not just, you know, I can't explain Spirit to you because you have your way of experiencing Spirit. But for me, Spirit, you know, God, you know, the universe has a sense of humor. Number one, it made me. But, you know, it has a sense of humor. It has a sense of love. It has a sense of everything. It knows everything. It knows things before us. It is everything. And our minds can't wrap around that. We have a hard time because we're trying to put it in a linear state. And you can't do that. You can't put Spirit in a box. The Spirit is more than a box. You know, just think about our brains. Our brains are, you know, have never seen light. So how do we know what we're looking at is light? This is a translation of energy. We translate, you know, we receive the energy, we receive the code, and we put it in our brain. We say that's light. You know, what if you didn't have vision? What if you didn't have touch? What if you didn't have sound? What if you didn't have any of your senses that we all have, all the five senses, but you still were alive? You would have some type of connection to Spirit. You would be connecting, you would be expressing in ways that would be completely different. It doesn't mean that you're no less and you don't exist. You just exist differently. Helen Keller's a good example. You know, she didn't have all her senses, but yet she found a way to connect. Somebody else found a way to help her connect. And that's what's beautiful about life. Life is not very mysterious. We call it mysterious because we can't explain certain things. But life is very adaptable. And life will adapt to certain situations and make it work. You know, human beings are like that. We just make things work sometimes. We don't always make the right choices about how we want to approach things, but we make the best of it. We make the best situations and we make them work. So that's why connections for me, you know, especially being with my dad in the last few days, being in the hospital, you know, and having that connection with him took me back in time with him to learn about his past, our history, our lineages, where we come from. The conquistadores in our family, and also the indigenous people in our family, the combination of the two, and how they intermingled and how they became, you know, another group of people. And so I got to listen to those stories, and that was, for me, that was powerful. That was very powerful because, you know, you hear about it and you've heard your dad talk about it, but you finally get to sit down and sit there for, you know, a good 8 hours with somebody, and they tell you things that, you know, are pretty amazing. You know, where you come from. One of my ancestors, you know, one of my grandsons, or Lemke, you know, he was a very big proponent for Native American and traditional stuff here in the United States and also in South America. And he was also one of the people who was assassinated by the Nazis because he was on a plot to assassinate Hitler. And I knew that, but it was an interesting story because I heard the whole story. You know, I heard the rest of it. And I thought that was fascinating. So it explains where I come from, where I am, who I am, why I act a certain way, and why I behave in certain fashions. Because there are also, you know, genetic things in my body, in my mind, that are also passed along to me and to my family and to the people that I know. So it was nice to sit there and listen. But the connections are amazing because, you know, while I was doing, I was connecting with my father, my sister and her husband and my nephew were at the house connecting with my mother, keeping her happy and keeping her well because she worries about my dad and she has polio, so she can't really move and she can't do a whole lot. But my brother-in-law and my nephew, they chopped wood today. You know, they chopped all the big logs that we had cut down over the course of a year. And then, you know, they stacked it all and get ready the basketball, you know, get it ready for, you know, for the coming, you know, spring and summer. And so for me, that was a beautiful thing. Those beautiful thing to see that, you know, the connections, how they all work. We don't all have to be in the hospital visiting Papagino, but, you know, we work together. We call, you know, there's different ways. You don't have to show up. Sometimes just making a simple phone call and saying, hey, how you doing? You okay? That's a connection. You know, we can stay angry at people because they said something to us or they treat us a certain way. But that's choice. That's free will. You know, if it serves you, fine. If it doesn't, then you got to figure out a way to move from that energy and get into a better space. Because if it doesn't, it'll stay with you. It'll be in there and you'll feel it. And you'll always look at that person and you won't always have that good feel. So these connections, you know, that I had, you know, with my father over the course of 2 days, you know, and I've known my dad since I was a little teeny popper when I was born. And just to see another version of him that I really, truly never had seen was really exciting for me. You know, I was really excited to just sit there. And, you know, and one of the last things he said to me, he goes, well, you know what, I don't want you to come tomorrow. I want you to spend the day. He talks like this. I want you to spend the day with your mom because it's her birthday. And I'm thinking, well, you know, we'll see how it all plays out. You know, I have a sacred drumming to do tomorrow for grieving for people who lost family members. But in the work that I do, it's amazing because all healing is self-healing. So I got to see him heal a part of himself, but through the physical and, you know, through the emotional, you know, to be humbled that, you know, he needs help, that he needed to take care of himself. I got to see that. And I thought that was pretty powerful, very powerful medicine. So ask yourself, what are your connections? I mean, how are your connections? Weak, severed? Do they even matter? Do you even need to bring things back into your life? But that was a cool thing, you know, to see other people connecting with my dad, the connection, and how they connect differently than I do. You know, how they see my father, how they see him in a different light, which I thought was really neat. Because we all have different relationships with different people. We express differently with others. We look at people, we hold people in a different, you know, frame of mind or a different light. And because I hold my father in the light of as a parent. Friends hold him as a light as a friend, you know, a commandant, somebody who's a comrade, somebody who is close to them in a different way. So it was really cool to see, especially, you know, all the friends who came by the last few days. And just to spend time with my dad. You know, I just got home, you know what, maybe an hour and a half ago. But I've been there all day with him because I felt like it's where I needed to be. And I think that's something that, you know, about being connected to somebody is knowing where you need to be at that time. Knowing where your spirit is calling you and where you need to be. So spirit connects with us in so many different ways. Spirit connects with us through animals, through the trees, through the wind, you know, through the church. You know, whatever, however you connect with spirit, you just connect. And sometimes we think that things have to be grandiose. But grandiose is different for everybody. You know, one's grandiose is much different than another's. So just being in the moment and appreciating the things that are just right in front of us. Maybe the sandwich, maybe petting your cat or your dog, talking to your neighbor. Those are very powerful moments. Those are very powerful moments that will be recorded in your mind forever in memory of our supercomputer. And those will never happen again. They won't happen again in the same fashion ever. They will never happen the same time, same moment, because it's very special. Very, very special. You'll never have the same sunset twice, ever. It's because it's different. The clouds have to be in a certain way. The sun may go down the same degree and angles. You know, you may be in from a different point of view. That's what's so cool about life. Life is like, it's a magic painting that's happening all the time. It's always evolving. It's always creating. It's always expanding. It's always getting more powerful, more beautiful. So that's what I enjoy about life is, you know, the moments. You know, I used to be one of those people who used to be really concerned about what happened to me in the past. Well, you know what I mean? It kind of forms people who you are today, but it doesn't either. And then I worried about things that, you know, were going to happen in the future. But then it's like, I got to a point where it's like, why? I have no control over that. I have no control. The only thing I have control of is what's happening right now. The only thing I have control over is being on this podcast, talking to you, looking at myself in the computer screen, talking to the mic, and, you know, telling my story. That's all I really have control of. I have no control of the weather. I have no control of the guys driving down the street. I have no control of what the government's doing right now. I have no control of the stars moving through the planet. I can only experience them. I can only, you know, watch them. And then through that watching, I can gather that experience and bring it into me, how it felt, how it moved me. So the only thing I have control of is just being here with you and sharing with you. And talking to you, and in talking about the things that are important to me. And the things that are important to me may not be important to you. But, you know, that's neither here nor there. It just is. What's important is that you're taking time to listen to the story that I've created for myself. So what I'm telling you is just my version of how I experienced my last few days. And for me, I know that I've condensed it. I know that I've reduced it. But I gave you the bullet points. I gave you the bullet points because I didn't want to drag it out too long. But it's a beautiful story to sit here and share with you what I've gone through. You know, I didn't talk about when I went to the waiting room and waiting, reading the magazine. But that's because that's kind of boring. I want to get you the meats and potatoes right off the bat. But, you know, it was fun to see my sister, you know, and her children coming and visiting Papi Gino and the relationship he has with them, which is completely different than he has with me. And to see that interaction and to witness that, to witness him interact with his grandkids and to interact with, you know, his daughter. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful to sit there to see them laugh and giggle, and because they have their own relationship, they have their own connection, they have their own things that they do together, things that that resonate with them. So, you know, ask you, what kind of connections do you have with people? And I know I've said that several times now, because, you know, our connections, we make them what we want them to be. You know, we can make the decision to heal ourselves, and by healing ourselves, we help others heal. There's so many of us that go around angry and upset with other people because of something they did. And I'm not justifying that what they did was right or wrong. I'm just saying we have a choice in the decision making if something is important for us to, you know, to move forward from. Or are we just going to continue the path that we're on? And you're allowed to continue on that path. You're allowed to continue that path of whatever serves you or doesn't serve you. But I find that, you know, to hang on to things sometimes is hanging on to a story that's not real. You know, the story's not real. For example, as I was going through my camera, you know, my digital camera here, my HD camera that I haven't really used for the last 3 or 4 years, but I've had it. I decided to pop it open and look at it and look through the videos. I found my sister's wedding video in there. And, you know, I'm thinking, boy, it's 4 years ago that I recorded that, and I don't think I ever gave it to her. So I made a conscious decision that I was going to make, add music to it and edit it and make it a little nicer and clean it up a little bit. And, you know, I didn't care if she liked it or didn't like it. That was not the point. The point for me was I wanted to present that to her because I know me that I probably said I was going to do that for her and I didn't. And, you know, and I made sure that when she called my dad, that my father would tell her that, you know, look, check in her email. And she was very grateful and very thankful for that. But that's 4 years ago. But, you know, it's the 4 year ago, 4 years ago doesn't really matter. What matters is that I took the time in the moment to actually work on that and get it to her. And, you know, what she does with it after that is really up to her and up to her husband. But I know she was happy because I could hear in her voice when I talked to her. And so just little things like that, you know, working on the 1 minute, you know, changes videos with David Two Crows, my friend, David Rutland, you know, putting those things together and recording his videos. It's just been a fun week. This week's been amazing. This week's been very powerful for me. You know, there's been a lot of good things happening on. And just letting things flow naturally and just let things flow, you know, from a place of love and the place of, you know, not expecting, which is really good. And even when my dad was in surgery, I wasn't too nervous because I knew he'd be okay. I knew he'd be okay because I had faith that he'd be okay. And was I in the surgery room with him praying for him? Sure. Cause he, you know, he had over 100 and some people praying for him because I cared enough to mention that, you know. And I was happy to see that everybody reached out and prayed for him because, you know, for a lot of people, my dad's a stranger at some level, but a lot of people know me. So then trust, you know, that this man is important to me. And thus, you know, they shared their love and their concern about him. And that made me very happy that, you know, people took time to do that. And the family in Peru was concerned about him. And, you know, but he's in recovery. He's coming back and he'll be back at it. I'm sure he'll talk about it a little bit on his posts. He's a good old dude. You know, I love my dad. And, but I want to thank you all for praying for him. Those of you who prayed for him and went to visit him and sent him energy and prayers. That means a lot to me. So, you know, I just say, you know, just check your connections. What's your connection with spirit? How are you connecting with family members? How are you connecting with friends? What are aspects that you can do to change? Things that you can, you know, reconnect yourself with? Because, you know, connecting is important. And not dictating to somebody else what they should believe is important. I believe that when we dictate, we're judging. And, you know, when we judge other people, we're really judging aspects of ourselves upon what we're looking at and why we don't agree with it. You know, in the end, it doesn't matter that rich people are always be rich. The poor, you know, had a chance to get out of the poverty if they truly want to, if they can. The middle class can still be strong if they choose to be. I think we have choice in a lot of what happens to us. There are certain circumstances where we might have to stand up and say, hey, you know what? This ain't working and we need to change it. And, you know, that's what we ought to do as human beings. That's what we ought to do as a nation, as a country, as world people, as ambassadors to, you know, our homes, to our friends. You know, just be a voice of connection, a voice of understanding, a voice to say, hey, you know what? Let's see if we're going to do this right. Let's see if we can connect in a better way. Let's see if all my relations is all my relations. Let's see if irisiqui is irisiqui and be grateful for the things that we are grateful for. Very powerful medicine. But with that, I don't have much more to say except for thank you for being with me tonight. I really appreciate you guys. And just be well. You know, I'll talk to you soon. I won't take, you know, more of your time tonight. And I will be on more sooner versus, you know, holding off. But I've been busy. So with that, I want to say thank you. You guys have a great evening. I'll talk to you soon. Be well. And yirisikwi, aho, atakuyasin, and I'll see you later.